the House has a new speaker who he said, he said he's ready to get to work and to find common ground. Now is the time. Now is the time to find common ground. Let's work together to ban assault weapons and high-capacity magazines. Let's work together to enact universal background checks, require safe storage of guns, and keep guns out of the hands of criminals and dangerous individuals who have no business being armed with a weapon of war.
Well, weapons of war built this country. That's KJP, who is saying, oh, we got a new House Speaker. She's thrown it. She's for on behalf of Biden. She's throwing it down to Republicans saying, well, look, we got a new speaker. So here's a list of things we want. And, you know, they're going to follow up with demands for an assault weapons ban with, oh, we got to have that Ukraine funding. They're going to attach that to Israel. And then they're going to want all of their budgetary stuff. They're going to want more government spending. They're going to want blank checks, everything. I kind of get the sense that they're not going to get it just from this speaker. So let's get some insight on this, because we know who Mike Johnson is on paper. I've never met him, but let's talk to people who actually know him. Our awesome representative from Texas, Chip Roy. Always good to see you, Congressman. Thank you so much. By the way, I love the art in your office. I love it. I love when you're in this corner because I love the background that you have. First off, tell us about, I mean, this has to be a major relief. I mean, it took for forever, but we finally got a House Speaker. Is this the outcome that you wanted?
Well, David, yeah, great to be on, and I do. I'm proud of my little Texas corner here, Austin, you know, great live music capital. Willie's behind me. I usually
Oh, I didn't even see that. That's great.
Yeah, exactly. 4th of July picnic. So got to represent. It's fine. And not exactly a bastion of conservatism in the music scene in Texas, but it's great music. So, and I've got some actually, surprisingly, some really good conservative friends in music that love to talk to me about it. But look, Mike Johnson is a man of impeccable character. You saw it in his speech at the rostrum there on the floor of the House. And what the American people need to know, the speech he gave there, he wrote it out and tightened it up a little bit, but he gave effectively the same speech with no notes from his heart the night before among Republicans in our conference meeting when we came to that conclusion late that night, because it's who he is. He's a constitutionalist. He believes in God. He believes that Jesus is his Lord and Savior. He believes in the founding principles of this country. He believes American is exceptional. He's a proud father of, I think, five with his beautiful wife. And he's from Northwest Louisiana, where my mom's from. My mom's from a town in the district he represents. And so Mike's a friend. He was someone that I've worked with closely on the Judiciary Committee. We don't always agree on a number of different issues, but that's okay. I mean, that's what we do in a republic. And so to answer your question, I think Mike's the right guy for the moment. He's well-liked and respected across the conference. And here's something that you need to know that's a good thing. Right now over in the Senate, they've been having meetings today. And I have it on good authority that a lot of the folks in the Senate were saying, wait, who is that? Who is Mike? And the reason that's important is because what happened this week was we broke the back of the entitlement establishment culture that believes that just because they are the ones that have been out doling out the money and doing all the power broker stuff, or they've had a position, that they're the ones that get to make all the decisions. And guess what? This is a new day. It may not be readily apparent tomorrow. We may not get all the wins we want tomorrow or the next day, but we are changing this town. And I think now we're setting up the fight that is going to be really serious over the coming weeks. They want to jam us with this massive omnibus supplemental bill. They want to jam us with a big omnibus spending bill in December. And I believe that Mike will stand with us and with conservatives to tell them to pound sand. But we got a lot of work to do in the coming weeks.
Yeah, talking with Congressman Chip Roy. I know he's part of the House Freedom Caucus. He's also, what is it, the Rules Committee or something to that effect. He's on base. The way it was described to me is that he's in a couple of different factions, which speaks volumes about, you know, some of the skills that he's going to need to get everybody together.
So Mike he's actually not in the Freedom Caucus, but Mike was the former executive director of the Republican Study Committee, which is kind of the center right block in the Republican Conference. He was the vice chairman of the Republican Conference, which is kind of the very low man on the totem pole of the leadership infrastructure. But importantly, he's a core and central member of the Judiciary Committee, working for Jim Jordan, the chairman of the Subcommittee on the Constitution. He is somebody who is on armed services. He's a deep understanding of our national security, a deep understanding of the law and our respect for the rule of law, and he's been out there leading on a lot of different conservative principles over the years that he's been in Congress. But the most important thing right now is that he's going to hopefully putting together good staff and bringing the right people in the room to figure out how to get this done. Because you and I have talked about this before. We get zero help from Democrats on any of the issues that any of your listeners care about. I cannot overstate that enough. Zero help. Anybody who goes out and says anything about border security or talking about limiting spending or talking about making sure our country is secure, standing with Israel, it is almost entirely lip service by the Democratic Party. So we're left with 221 Republicans figuring out how to do something to try to fight to save this country with Democrats in charge of the Senate and the White House, and no Democrats in the House willing to work with us on anything meaningful to limit spending, secure our border, make sure our military is strong and not being destroyed through social engineering. And so that's the tough job that Mike has. It was a tough job for Kevin. It would have been a tough job for anybody, and it will be a tough job for Mike. But Mike has something that has been sorely lacking, and that is a fresh perspective that isn't the next man up in the game of the establishment here in Washington.
Yeah, it's interesting because he seemed to come out of nowhere, and a lot of people, I mean, we've heard of him, and we kind of were familiar with his record. Obviously he's in Congress. I heard of who he was familiar with his record. I have some friends out in Louisiana that seem pleased by him. They're happy with his representation. But he's not somebody I followed. I definitely didn't have him on my bingo card for this. That's what was so surprising. I mean, his name comes out of, you know, right field. I'm like, where is this happening at? Mike Johnson, it's him. But I think, just as you were saying, that underscores that's not the list of usual suspects. Not to use that as a pejorative, but you know, it wasn't the list of people that we were expecting.
Yeah, and look, I mean, understand when you've got your list of usual suspects, who are the people that are in this town,
right,
that are in the leadership positions, and they're loved by K Street, or they're the ones that, oh, they're the ones that can do this, Chip. Don't you understand? They've got the team, they've got the expertise, they've got the experience, they know everybody, they can do it. That's code for, hey, we can use them. We, the establishment in this town, we can work with them. And then they look at someone like me and they'll go, there's going out there and we're out on the tip of the spear out here trying to go fight and get information to people, call balls and strikes. Well, guess what? You're going to ruffle some feathers when you do that. When you go in and you go down to the floor and you say, you know what? That bill is garbage and I'm not supporting it. I'm not going to allow you to do that. And they go, wait, how dare you, young man? You can't do that. And so these are the things that you have to balance. Mike is frankly kind of a cross section there, in which Mike has worked with the team, and he was the vice chair of the conference. He ran the Republican study committee, put a lot of good policies out, but he's also been out there working with people like us when we're out there on the tip of the spear. And we all have our different roles, right? There was the Patrick Henrys and there were the James Madisons. And so we all have to kind of figure out how this will play out. And I'm happy to continue to be at the tip of the spear, because frankly, ain't no time to waste. And we got to get out there and get the job done.
Well, just for future arguments, though, if we find ourselves in this, he already knows where I'm going. I can tell by expression on his face. If we find ourselves in this position again, Congressman Roy, can you just nix all of it and just say, you know what? I'm going to be speaker. Don't even say I'm not even going to nominate myself. I'm going to be speaker. You're going to vote for me. That's the end of it. And just get it done with.
Yeah, well, Dana, you know what the answer is. Mike Johnson is our speaker. And
I know, but just saying, like, you know, things happen. Things can change. After that, in the future, I'm just saying, will you be open to just solving all the problems and just getting it over with?
So, Dana, when you take a massive pay cut and come in as my communications director, you come and advise me what my answer is.
That would be a nightmare for you. I appreciate you at least entertaining the idea. All right. But now we got business, because we're looking at the future of a Republican-controlled House. It's still a small amount of control, just a few seats by which Republicans control. Yeah. Is this, going forward, what's a game plan? Because, you know, we're looking at another shutdown. We're going into election season, going into the holidays. People get resentful. What's a game plan?
Yeah, well, first of all, the most important thing we need to do is stop the ridiculous Biden administration and Senate Democrat, along with Senate Republican, play to try to jam the House with a big, what they're calling an omnibus supplemental bill, which would be Israel, yes, but Ukraine, Taiwan, and a bunch of money for the border, which will do nothing but process more people and not actually secure the border. They're talking about almost $100 billion. That is insane. We must oppose it. I believe we will oppose it. I believe the Speaker will oppose it. I'm encouraging the Speaker to oppose it. And instead, we should send over a Israel-only bill that is paid for, because just color me crazy, I just think maybe Republicans should pay for these things and go cut bad programs or existing dollars and say, you know what? We need to help our friends with Israel. Cut this bad program. Let's go help Israel.
Yeah.
But then let's set the stage for the next round, which is what are we going to do when we get to the government funding issue on November 17th? Let's figure out what our plan is going to be. We're having those conversations now. It's not easy because we're up against the time, right? We got about 3 weeks left to go figure that out. And so we got to do that. And then we need to make sure that we're being very clear about Ukraine. We will not move anything for Ukraine. In my view, we should not, unless it is transparent, fully accounted for in terms of what has been spent before, with a clear mission of what we're trying to accomplish, doled out over time to the extent that there is any money at all tied directly to HR2 and border security measures and a complete halt to the releases of people into the United States. You cannot have money flowing to Ukraine if we're not securing our border. If any money flows to Ukraine at all, which should only occur if they come and show us how it's in our national security interest and how the dollars are being used to actually accomplish the objective.
Exactly, which we haven't. We should allow, like, if Taiwan wants to buy, you know, armament from us, we should sell it to them. That could, like, go towards paying for some of Israel's, some of their aid. Congressman Chip Roy, always appreciate the candor. Good to see you, my friend. And thanks for fighting the good fight.
Thanks, Dan. It's Adam, Chris, and look forward to seeing you soon. Take care.
Will do. Thanks so much, sir.